before I forget what it's called.
Wow, that's really bright. That's not good.
Out of the blue.
A very gray day.
It doesn't really fit in this car. I really didn't expect to like it this much.
What's up, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this POV review by Autotop.nl. My name is Max, and today you join me on a very dreary day, a very gray day, and a very gray Volkswagen Touareg, the new model, the third generation. And let's get this out of the way before I forget what it's called. We've got an antimonial silver one today. And well, I'm going to do a walk around, show you all the new stuff on the outside. We'll take it for a drive on this road towards the Autobahn and do a quick Autobahn blast to finish off. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you're not a subscriber yet. And hit that bell to receive notifications when we upload a new video. All right, the new Touareg. More like an Audi than ever, I have to say. We've got the special 3D tail lights, which I think look great. The Touareg overall has grown. It's longer, it's wider, and it's lower. So it has a much better appearance, if you ask me. A lot of chrome on the grille, very large front, which give it a very aggressive look. We've got the upgraded LED matrix headlights with IQ lighting or something like that. So if we turn them on, you can see that, you know, there's a headlight right there. Well, that's really bright. And there are several down there. And the cool thing is that it can actually bundle the light and it can make gaps in them. So if you're driving on a road which is completely dark, it can sort of make a hole in them if you have a car in front of you. So the person in front of you doesn't get blinded by your lights, but still you have the bigger lights. You have the full beam. We've got 20-inch wheels, which are an option. We've got an R-Line package. I have to say, it is a handsome car, this new Touareg. It is good looking, if you ask me. Okay, I'm going to get in because it is raining. So boot space has grown by like 118 liters. So it's at something like 800 something liters, which is a lot. We've got this Tacoma brown and black two-tone leather. We've got oak wood inside. And, well, the pièce de résistance is, of course, this new system. It's called Innovation, like innovation, but Innovation. This is a 15-inch screen, and that's the 12-inch virtual cockpit, which is optional. You can also still get analog dials, apparently. And they have sort of designed it so that it seems like it's one screen, with the shape of the grille in here as well. Again, that wood, really nice, sort of open bore, goes all the way around. And this system is sort of designed to look like a smartphone. So you have this home button right here. You can switch between your home screens. And let's get the ambient lighting going, which we also have, which is also an option. There it is. Brightness full on. And you can select the colors with this sliding selector. So you can go from everything, you know, red, yellow, orange, green, teal, blue, purple, pink, everything. And it's actually really nicely done with these little dots right here. And this line that goes all around the car, and even the color inside the menu changes as well. So if I go to green, everything changes. And even in this screen as well. So a very comprehensive ambient lighting. Let's go for Autotop blue.
and start it up. So we've got the 3-liter V6 diesel today, which has a couple of different versions. There is a 231 horsepower version and a 286 horsepower version. We've got the 286. So we've got the top model, the atmosphere edition, which means you get a lot of options already. And we've got an 8-speed Tetronic automatic gearbox, which is not great, but I'll tell you some more about that later. And because you have this screen, everything is in there. So you have very little buttons left on the dash. You've got the gear lever, the start stop button, your parking brake and auto hold, the volume button, which is probably the cheapest thing in this car. Listen to this.
That's not good.
Sounds like something from a transporter. But what I do really like is that you still have these two buttons, these dials, which have been there since the first generation Touareg, I think. So this is for your driving modes. You can press this menu button and you get it on the screen, but you can also just turn the knob. And this one is for the air suspension. Also an option, this car has it. You can raise it and lower it depending on your mood and terrain. So, did I miss anything? We've got the upgraded Dynaudio audio system as well. This car is really, really fully spec'd, and it feels that way. It feels very, very modern, and it truly is the VW flagship right now, especially when it comes to tech, because it is loaded. And because it is on the MLB Evo platform, which is the same as the Porsche Cayenne, the Audi Q7, Q8, the Lamborghini Urus, and the Bentley Bentayga, it means you also get the tech underneath as an option. So, as I said, it has air suspension, but you can also select a package which combines that with four-wheel steering, virtually taking out, you know, a slice of the wheelbase, and it means that it's just a lot more agile in cities and stuff, and with parking. It also has the 48 volt electromechanical anti-roll bars, so it stabilizes itself, which works really well too. And more than ever, the Touareg is sort of the silent star, the silent hero. It's just an SUV. It doesn't have, apart from this huge screen, it's not, you know, ostentatious. It's not shouty. It's not in your face. It just does what it needs to do and nothing more. And especially these days, you know, the competition, BMW X5, Porsche Cayenne, Audi Q7, Lexus RX maybe, Mercedes GLE, it's a lot of shoutiness and blingy, and it's not really about being an SUV anymore. And this does still feel like that. The other ones feel more like a horse fit for dressage, and this is more like a workhorse on a farm. Which is, you know, that's a big accomplishment considering the fact that it does have LED matrix super smart IQ headlights, and it does have 3D rear lights, and it does have this huge screen, but still it feels like a true farmer's SUV. The only thing I really, really don't like until now in here is this steering wheel. I mean, it's the same steering wheel you get in a Polo or a Golf or a Tiguan or a VW Crafter or a Transporter or whatever. It just feels a bit cheap and it doesn't really fit in this car. I think they should have gone for a bit nicer steering wheel. These buttons should have been a bit nicer. The wheel itself should have been a bit thicker and more squishy. The rest feels quite premium, but the steering wheel really doesn't. So sort of lets it down a bit, which is a shame. So with that 3-liter V6 diesel with 286 horsepower and 600 newton meters, it will do 0 to 100 kilometers an hour in 6.1 seconds. Top speed is 235, which which is not bad either. And it actually means that from all the VW Group SUVs with this engine, this is actually the quickest. It's quicker than an Audi Q7, quicker than an Audi Q8, because it is about 200 kilos lighter than an Audi Q8 and about 150 kilos lighter than an Audi Q7. Because it is on that new platform and it sort of shares a lot of parts, like aluminium suspension, a lot of aluminium in the bodywork, it's actually more than 100 kilos lighter than the previous Touareg. And it also means that the engine feels a little more powerful than the engine in the Audi Q8. Still though, I mean, it doesn't feel that refined. So when you do stuff like this, it's okay. But if you drive it like around town and you hear that engine, it sort of feels like an old school diesel, and it sounds like an old school diesel, which is a shame because the rest of the car feels really refined. So that's 230 kilometers an hour, close to the top speed. We have to brake, unfortunately. As you can see, you do need quite a bit of space to get there, especially from 220 to 235. But this engine actually feels adequate in this car. It, especially if you drive it at like 60, 70% throttle, it feels nice and torquey. And as I said, it actually feels a bit more powerful than the Audi brothers, which are a bit heavier. When you drive it like this on the Autobahn, that air suspension is brilliant. It really filters out every little ridge, every bump. You can really cover a lot of distance, you know, in comfort. It absorbs all the bumps. But it is an option. So as standard, it comes on regular springs with adaptive dampers, but I would really recommend going for this air suspension because it is beautiful. So bumps like this, no problem. We know this Autobahn so well that we know where the bumps are, and we know when you have to slow down for bumps like those. But in this, you can just power through. This car also has the optional extra silenced windows, so the extra thick windows and extra tinted as well. So wind noise is not bad actually for such a large car. And I have to say that I really didn't expect to like it this much. It really feels like the thinking man's SUV. It has always been that, but now more than ever, this car offers so much value for money that, you know, it is a serious contender. Even within the VW group, this is one to watch, because I don't think that any other SUV offers this much gear and tech and comfort for this amount of money. One downside to all that tech is that the lane assist is automatically engaged every time you get in the car, so you have to go into the menu, deselect it, and then close the menu again every time you drive it, because you can't really switch it off. Alright, so all that talk about power and performance, let's actually go into sport mode. The modes are mostly ECU, throttle, and suspension, so they have sacrificed part of the off-road capabilities of the Touareg. It does have a center differential, but it doesn't have a rear locking differential. So, you know, while it is relatively capable off-road, it's not a true off-roader anymore. It has moved more towards the premium luxury SUV like the Q7. But let's be honest, most people won't really take it off-road. So sport mode means that the suspension tightens up, the throttle response is a bit more aggressive, the steering gets a bit heavier. But, you know, doesn't really mean that it becomes a sporty car or anything like that. Just a very good travel companion, this car. You can fit so much crap in the back. And, you know, it's just, it's quiet, it's comfortable. It is a very, very capable car, this. So, more than ever, a serious contender and a serious competitor to the more premium car. So you have to decide for yourself how much you care about that badge. I mean, that's sort of all this is about now. Do you need that Porsche badge, that Audi badge, that BMW badge, that Mercedes badge, or do you go for the VW badge, which is, you know, a lot less coveted and a lot less desirable maybe, but it does mean that it offers a lot of value for money. So that's it for this review. I hope you enjoyed it. You can subscribe by clicking the big button. You can check out this POV review of a Porsche Cayenne e-hybrid, and you can check out this POV reviews playlist. Thanks for watching, guys, and we'll see you at the next one. Bye.